starting by the conclusions of your presentation, mm-hmm. that provides a fresh perspective and a fresh balance on the results of the popular struggles and new forms of social movements in this post neoliberal reform age. And you even spoke confidently of a second incorporation of popular sectors. Could you elaborate on that? Tell us why do you think that is the case?
Okay. I conceptualize the process that I have researched in Argentina, that is a process that goes approximately from the mid-90s, 94 and 96, till nowadays. That's the second way of incorporation of the popular sectors, because I find a series of parallelisms with what had happened in Argentina in the what was considered, generally considered, the first incorporation of the popular sectors as laborers through trade unions in the political arena. I conceptualize this process as the second wave of incorporation because I find that, as in the first incorporation, there is a constitution of a new social question as a result of a series of policies that are ignoring in some way the consequences of, in this case, the neoliberal state reforms in the 19th century of a liberal state that was not involved that much in social policies in that period. And then I find that the parallelism is that because of this, there is also the emergence of organized resistance to the consequences that the policies are building. And as a result of this resistance process, as way of organizing these popular sectors emerge in Argentina, at least in the 19th century till the 30s or 40s, there is an increased contention produced by trade unions and labor organizations of different kinds, mostly coordinated by anarchist communists, etc., and also with some support from the Socialist Party. In the period I researched, that goes from the 1990s of the 20th century to the 21st century, there is an emergence of a different kind of actor, that is the piqueteros, the unemployed workers' movement, that is also working with support and coordination with other left-wing parties and the peronist parties that gradually increase their coordination capacity and disruption capacity in order to push the state towards building social policies. In both cases, there's a parallelism. So I go through the analysis of this kind of parallelism, seeing how the emergence of a new social question produces then the constitution of a repressive and social policies in both countries, in the same country, in both periods, and how then this produces a recognition of the existence of a claim, a new claim that was not considered by these reforms. And that claim that is recognized then produces the legitimation in a new actor. In Argentina in the 40s is the legitimation of the trade unions as the actor that is related to the incorporation of this new, this mass of the population that was outside the political institutional arena, that is, that makes the women's vote, then the creation of the Secretary of Employment, and then the creation of a series of policies and for welfare and regulation of state labor and private sector labor relationships, that in the 90s happens in some way also with the unemployed workers movement. The re-emergence, that's why I call it a second wave or a reincorporation, because it's not that history is being like starting there. There's a continuation of the first incorporation that exists, institutions from that period that they are not dissolved, but they are including new ones, like the re-emergence of the area of social development that was closed since the 60s till the 90s, that upgrade of the secretary to a ministry of social development, the changes in the role of repressive institutions like the Gendarmería, the military police, that grows from border control to social unrest and informal ways to a change in the procedures of this institution that are similar also to things that happen in the Tracy Corporation. This goes forward then towards in producing the concrete incorporation of actors coming from these organizations in the state. That means that in Argentina, part of the piqueteros entered into the coalition in government in 2002, and then in this happens also in the 30s and 40s, the 40s and 50s in Argentina, and then this also is added to the electoral participation of the piqueteros, that they participate as parliamentarians, they win some seats in the national level, not that much, but they have a couple. But they have much more success on the local and provincial level when they reach also electoral positions. So in this sense, there is a process that produces a gradual expansion of the political arena towards actors that were previously in the political arena, because of the popular sector. They were previously incorporated in the 30s and 40s. They are excluded and reabsorbed. That's why it's a second wave. But this reabsorption, you could say this reincorporation, is done in new terms, and that's one of the interesting things. While the first incorporation was done under cooperativist logic, so they were creating institutions for the arrangement by very established actors that negotiate different kinds of universal agreements, that is trade unions, the Unión Industrial Argentina or equivalent, and the rural owners and the Catholic Church, these clear actors. In the second way of incorporation, the territorial dimension is a crucial one. The territorial dimension means that these actors that are outside any kind of corporativist institution are organized through their participation at the local level. That doesn't mean that they are local in their approach. They work in the shanty towns, in the neighborhoods, in different kinds of areas that are not necessarily equivalent to any kind of electoral district or any kind of a specific corporative organization. So they are working in simultaneous with the other kind of logic. So because of this other logic that this movement has, that is territorialization, the second way of incorporation has to deal with this kind of category, where they cannot be represented directly and easily through just transmitting this into a electoral participation. Because, for example, the Federación de Trabajadores por la Tierra y Bien de Hábitat, the FTB, have land occupations where they are organized that are in Quilmes, Florencio Varela, and different districts at the same time. And so the neighborhood is not necessarily limited to participating electorally in only one district. They share several at the same time. So because of this characteristic, they cannot electorally participate in one. They can participate in several at the same time, but at the same time, they even share their relationship with these other actors. So because of this kind of logic, the second way of incorporation applies policies that are built in a different way. Instead of creating different kind of institutions for the articulation of corporativist interests, in this case, they are creating institutions for the negotiation across actors that share the disputes for a territory. So what was created, for example, in Argentina, that generally is neglected as just clientelism or cooptation, but is much more complex than that, is the change of the Secretaría General de la Presidencia role for a period. Nowadays, it's not anymore like this, but it was from 2003 to 2008, nine ladies. Through the integration of a sort of consultative body of piqueteros organizations inside the Secretaría General de la Presidencia, as a way of articulating the interests of these organizations that share the interest and participation in the coalition in government and the presidency. This articulation was built on the one side, obviously, to demobilize them, but on the other side also in order to integrate their interests and articulate them, while there was no institution in the official structure of the state that could fit them. And that's one of the key issues. Because that also happens in Brazil, and for what I know, also in Bolivia, like, and they are a sort of the elite's reply towards a very mobilized actor that cannot fit in institutions. Till they start building this Ministry of Social Development as an institution for the second wave of incorporation actors. So in that sense, it becomes very interesting the process of building institutions to deal with a new social question that is not anymore the social question that came from the labor movement that still exists, but is institutionalized, have the Ministry of Labor, have laws that have a century of history, some laws are even a century old. That doesn't mean that they are outdated, but that there's a strong tradition of relationship, mostly in Argentina, but maybe other countries in Latin America. But Brazil also has a strong tradition in corporatist institutions. But these actors emerge claiming for again incorporating themselves as crucial actors in socioeconomic and political terms, but they cannot be fitted in any of these institutions. As they emerge, the state builds new institutions and add new spaces in the state to deal with them. Obviously, as this process is newer, it has between 15 and 20 years. In long-term historical senses, it's not as big yet as the first incorporation process. But we can still nowadays see how these new institutions were built and how these institutions are working. Some of them have at least 10 years of history now. And how new social policies were built, social policies that are not any more than in labor terms, like cash transfer policies, that are built through a logic that is family-based, or policies that are based like the cooperative's support for house building, that is based on territorial terms. And these are logics that, during the first incorporation, were, it doesn't mean that was ignored house building, but was not done in the same logic and with the same understanding of social policy. It was done in order to support the labor participation in the economy and society. And now it's not necessarily done for that support. Obviously, we are talking always of the same sector of society, that is the popular sector. That's why I don't talk of working class or labor. I talk about the popular sectors that are the same social sector of society that first was done under labor terms, and now in Argentina, it's done under territorial terms. Territorial terms can be translated in different countries in different ways. For example, in Bolivia, first incorporation is much weaker than in Argentina, never arrived to the degrees of institutionalization of Argentina, but already happened in some way. It happened through the consideration of indigenous people in that period as peasants, so there was the creation of institutions for the articulation of peasant interests, and also through mostly the mining sector, where there was the strongest and mostly organized sector of the labor movement. In this second way, these two categories are not anymore the key ones. Evo Morales built a sort of assembly system that he meets every now and then in the presidency with movements and indigenous groups that go and dialogue with him, and then he meets the cabinet, transmitting in some way another way of producing claims. And this is because in the second way, these peasants, that is the popular sectors, again, is the popular sectors in Bolivia, are in the second way of incorporation incorporated as indigenous or as coca growers, etc. But these are not anymore incorporated as the labor movement, the working class. So then the conflict starts to become territorial, diverse, and so then he has to deal with the Alto and the Amazonian and etc. regions in different ways, as in equivalent but different terms happens in Argentina, when they have to deal with claims that come from petroleum enclaves and claims that come from the Greater Buenos Aires area that are different, and then inside the Greater Buenos Aires area that is enormous for Argentina in electoral and contentions and demographic terms, they're very big diversity. So how you deal in different ways with this. And this can be also said of the other country. I can enter into details as well. See that I know a lot about that country, you know, to explain it in the sentence. I know less other countries, but for what I have been reading about other authors, it seems to also can be said about other countries. Not all countries are following this certain way, but there are some that can be said that being following this second way. Also, another interesting thing that I find in approaching this process, not just as the left turn into power, is because, at least for Argentina and Brazil, most of these policies were not done by the left. The beginning of the incorporation process is previous, as in the first incorporation process. The main policies for incorporating the labor movement in Argentina or in Brazil was not Perón and Vargas. Perón and Vargas consolidated the process and built the institutionalization of the process. But there is a process of sedimentation and accumulation of this kind of policies for at least one decade before. And in the cases I study, it happens the same. The first social policies for unemployment are done by men in the 90s. The Secretary of Social Development is reopened in 94. The ministry is the upgrading of the secretary is in 1989 under neoliberal policies. What it happens is that in 2004, this new ministry is clearly institutionalizing its role through a decree that says that it has to deal with certain specific policies that was already dealing with, but was not institutionalized in its conflict with the Ministry of Labor. So this is the kind of process that happened. It's like an accumulation across time. And this same is what is interesting also, is that in order not to, in my opinion, consider that this is just the left turn, there are countries that are not in the same degrees of leftness, you could say, no? It's not the same, the process that is happening in Bolivia and the process that is happening in Brazil, even though, in my opinion, they are all second wave of incorporation processes. The degrees of continuity of Lula from Cardoso are much higher than the degrees of continuity that exist between the previous governments in Argentina and Bolivia and nowadays Evo Morales or Cristina or Néstor Kirchner. And this doesn't mean that in one case neoliberalism is continued as it was. Like, there are much more degrees of continuity in Brazil than in the other countries, but there is a complete reformulation of the relationship of the state with the popular sector source. This massive creation of councils, the creation also in the Secretaría General de la Presidencia in Brazil of an institution for dealing with territorial actors, and also the incorporation of the landless workers movement in landless peasant movement, sorry, in different offices in the state during Lula first and second government was very important. And these are parallelism that are very interesting, even though the degrees of changes are different. But at the same time, the policies are done in a different way than before. But at the same time, as in the case of Argentina, is Cardoso the first one that does cash transfer policy at the national level. Has also a longer history, but at the national level is Cardoso under neoliberalism. And also agrarian reform, as in my understanding, is during Cardoso, like it's a common agreement, it's a very massive policy, maybe the biggest agrarian reform in the history of Brazil, is, in my opinion, a compensatory policy. It's an equivalent policy to unemployment policies in Argentina. It's a policy that can absorb, in some way, those that are excluded from neoliberal policies, and in some way, is the most massive policy during Cardoso era that have compensated the victims of neoliberal reforms. And that can be seen through information that says that around 40% of the people that were occupying rural lands come from the urban environment, and that movements like MST, Movimientos Trabajadores en Tierra, were purposely mobilizing urban and employed poor people in the rural area, because there was the key people for mobilizing. There were the incorporated popular sectors. Because nowadays Brazil is a much more rural society than before, etc. So in that sense, we can find that there are different degrees of transformation, also as it happened in the first incorporation process, as was studied by Ruth Coy and David Kolicek in the Equity Arena. The degrees of incorporation are very different from Argentina to Peru, to Bolivia, and from Chile to Brazil. There are different kinds of similarities. Brazil and Chile have similarities in that process. There are different kinds of break with the oligarchic past. There are different kinds of production of strong workers' movement. And now, obviously, none of the other countries arrived to the same degree of Argentina, but all the same, in other countries, there was creation of institutions for them. So this kind of degrees of gray between a macro process, I think that we can find. And so to just reduce this nowadays process to the access of the left to government, it's part of the story, because it's true that there are center-left parties mostly into power. But it's just to go for the electoral dimension of this process. And there's a bigger picture that we can see that is previous to them, that is linked to them, and in my opinion continues after them. Like, it's very difficult to see that, even though if tomorrow non-center-left government wins the elections in any of these countries, Venezuela could be another discussion, it could produce a complete change of this kind of policies. I think that as it happened with first incorporation policies, after you have the end of the incorporation period, that will produce some sort of stabilization or some institutionalization of rules. Some will be changed again, some others no, but the core will be preserved, and it becomes a sort of accumulation in the past. So even though maybe then there's a distribution of budget from one area to the other, I don't imagine that even if a right-wing party wins elections in the next election, theoretically in any country, will close the Ministry of Social Development, or will then eliminate cash transfer policies. They will make change, but...
Well, to some extent, has been the case in Chile.
Yes.
Now, based on what you're saying, there is... one difference that seems to me very significant, which is in this second wave, as a difference from the first one, there is no partisan actor that can actually claim this new movement as a stable constituency, that it's far more contingent and permanently renegotiated the relationship between social movements and political parties. Is that the case in your...
Well, talking in particular about Argentina, what is, it becomes really relevant is that the main labor-based parties is first incorporation, that is the Partido Justicialista or Peronist party of parties, there are several, but mostly the Partido Justicialista, and there are, yes, exclusively the Confederación General del Trabajo, the CGT, the main union in the 90s of Argentina, have produced a sort of detachment from the organization of the popular sectors. The labor-based history was preserved more in rhetorical than concrete terms, and because of Menem being one of the main promoters of the neoliberal reforms, if he was thinking of doing that before or not, to a discussion, but he actually did it, and based on the support of the first incorporation actors, he massively they incorporated with the support of the first incorporation actors. So this detached these actors from the popular sectors, from those that were losing the relationship of these new changes of the political area. So this detached the representation dimension. So in some sense, in the second incorporation process, they become less relevant. What we see is that, I am now talking about Argentina, that first incorporation trade unions split. That is something that in Argentina is quite difficult to do because it's a very corporatist in that sense, system. And split creating the Central de Trabajadores Argentinos, and then there are some other divisions. There are less capacity of the CGT to coordinate at the factory level because they are much bigger defiance coming from this factory level, something that is not completely new from history. That also happened. The 1969 Cordobazo has very much to do with that also, no? To factory level organization by left-wing actors in cooperation with the left of the Peronist Party and other sectors not agreeing with that, but happens all the same. Well, we have these also, no? There's not complete new things, but the difference is that this happens in a more massive way, while the CGT is trying to keep the power they have, their share of the cake. They try to keep it through clientelism, through patronage, through agreement, but also in some sort of logical terms. They have built a sort of a quantity of laws and benefits for their constituency that they tried just to keep it. So they were more reactive. But this was not shared by all the movement sector. I created a new movement that are mostly state workers, teachers, that are the big losers of the reforms, that mobilize. This is added to the fact that this movement, like the Piqueteros, emerges, and this complexity of new actors that are mostly territorialized have difficulties to be translated in the electoral system in party terms, because of what I said before. They are not working by electoral units. They are not based on logics that are electoral, even though they participate in the electoral competition, even building parties, they are related to parties, they informally participate in the electoral process, supporting candidates, boycotting candidates, negotiating positions, clientelism, doing protests in order to push the agenda, whatever. But what they are doing is, but the core of their way of organization is based on another kind of cleavage. And that cleavage is this territorial one. And this territorial one is based on the claims for habitat, for access to a different kind of environment where they are living, that includes having a job, includes to participate in the electoral process, but transcends that. And then it becomes difficult by the parties to respond to that at the very beginning of this incorporation process. I'm talking about the 90s, because of the detachment. And the clientelistic networks that were very much researched in the 90s are part of a sort of reply of the party to deal with this detachment. But this was part of the story, no? This clientelism that still exists and is still organized is part of the way these popular sectors relate to the parties. But there are also these other sectors that sometimes participating simultaneously in the clientelistic relationship, also mobilized and contend against the same mayor that they are asking for something before. So, and then because of this movement being in this district and at the same time in this other district, they mobilize against both at the same time. And these two mayors are of different parties that they compete against themselves. So they open another kind of discussion that is not anymore the relationship between a clear constituency that will vote this mayor and in the claim for some sort of reply. They are claiming to several mayors at the same time. And these several mayors are not necessarily going to be benefited in electoral terms by these people, because maybe these people are not voting in any of these districts. But at the same time, they need to reply because there is a dispute that is based on the control of that territory. On the control, that means for the elite sector, governability, as can be seen as the dimension of governability, how to keep that district under some sort of control. And on the side of the movement can be seen through the production of social policies or different kind of replies that sometimes are not so institutional as social policies, but some sort of socio-economic or also sometimes recognition policies towards what they are claiming that are more difficult to translate in electoral terms. So in that sense, I think that this is very interesting to see, and that, in my opinion, explains also why, at least in Argentina, the party system has high difficulties to translate this into an reorganization of the party system. And the story, how it will continue, I don't know it, but what I at least think is that at least there's a new cleavage that has been introduced to the other ones. It has not changed the other ones, but that is pushing in some way political competition towards adding a different way, a different logic that is in added there. How and will be added? The story is still continuing, no? We are at least half, in in the middle of this process, at least, in my opinion. I am talking at this as a medium term process or long term process. I think that we are seeing these kind of transformations. That how the party system will change to reply to this, and we have to still see it. We could see some replies in the trade union system, much clearer than in the party system. The emergence of unions like the CTA, that has a factory level organization, but that they consider that the factory is not the core of their interest, and that the territory, they explicitly say the territory is their core, and that their constituency is in the territory, and that the way they have to see what is their constituency as an union is not the laborer, is the family. And the family implies those that are working in the factory, that have been working in the factory because now they are pensioners, not necessarily unemployed. They are employed, but also the housewife in traditional terms, that has been working on a lot and that has not been recognized by the traditional way of recognition. The kids, the rest of the extended family, and also how they deal with that territory. That territory is not anymore the traditional labor district where they have a factory there. Now there is it's mostly a dormitory district with no factory nearby. So it has changed also that relationship. So in these terms, I think that the trade union system, at the half of it, we have been seeing some kind of changes there and some sort of interesting approaches towards this, like mobilizations that happen in different periods for what they call the CTA, the paritaria social, that is the claim for the traditional negotiations of the trade union system through cooperative arrangements for universal increases on salary, but they call it social because they were also including several other claims that are not labor focused, but that are intrinsic to that worker's life, no? That was also, they were including changes in education budget, changes in the unemployment subsidies, improvement of access to water. There were several other characteristics, several changes in their specific area. So, in some way, the trade union system tried to reply at least half of it, because the CGT mostly preserve a neo-corporativist arrangement, but sectors of the CGT, that the worker, the workers that are related to that are in the construction area, that is a union that mostly has informal workers inside, in some way. There are workers that are in the building industry that in Argentina are mostly working through what they call changas, that is very informal, and the workers have been having intensive conflicts with the piquetero sector because their constituency is much more shared than teachers or professors' union, where it's mostly middle classes and have been suffering an increase on their salaries, but not necessarily unemployment. And they live in another district, and they have different kind of complexity that is much similar to middle classes' needs. So in that sense, this kind of union, like OCRA, has reacted also to this. In a different way as they are, they have reacted in which way? They have opened, in quite massive terms, local branches inside neighborhoods in order to be in touch with what is happening in the neighborhood, not only in factories, first because they don't have factories as a way of interacting, so for them was much needed and quicker the reaction that was necessary, and these kind of changes are being produced. They seem to be irrelevant when we see the macro process, but as this accumulates, it changes the union system. It changes the way of representing the laborers in a more complex dimension. I think that of all these actors, parties are the ones that have been suffering but reacting the less, we could say. Because until now, what we seems to be seeing are the atomization of the non-Peronist parties, creation of very personalistic parties with very weak structures, and an enormous factionalization of the Peronist sector inside the Partido Justicialista and outside also the Partido Justicialista. That seems to be a multiplication of individuals that are disputing. But this, at least in the permis sector, that is the one that has more territorial penetration of the party system, this is also introducing a territorial dimension. This functionalization of the permis party is not based on ecological distinctions, it's not based on electoral disputes necessarily. It's generally based on the control of a territory. Generally, mayors compete among themselves, even though they are all of the parent party, because of reasons that are not electorally based. They are based on who can show to be the one that is wiser in the capacity of controlling its own territory, how they can build better relationship with unions and movements, and how they can that way show that they can represent better that district because they think it in these representative terms. And in some way, this representation, even though it's not being necessarily reflected in electoral terms, it's reflected in governability terms, how they can keep under control that territory. And this is an interesting territorial dimension because this dimension of territorial control in some way changes the way of disputing that they have. And for what I have been studying, this has been unequally happening across the country. And have been happening more where we have something that is crucial, that is another actor that emerges to contend in the territory. So where we have more of these are in like the Greater Buenos Aires area, for example, that has the highest density of piqueteros organization. I'm not doing piqueteros organization, there are occupied factories, human rights movement, different kinds of local organizations, also churches, the Evangelist Church, Caritas, and etc., that they have priests that are left-leaning and right-leaning priests that are also disputing who deals with the popular sectors and in which ways. And the popular sectors are dealing with all of them, so they are negotiating in some way, formally conscious and unconsciously, they are dealing with this. But this is including a different kind of groups with different kind of values for that specific space. Till now, this is not expressed in a new configuration of the party system. I don't know if this will go in that direction or not. But it seems is that a new logic is being added. To what degree that will change the party system, I don't know. Till now, it seems that the party system entered into a crisis and is experiencing this crisis. I cannot tell how the story will continue.